The Church of Rock.
But right now, a man that's more dangerous than you even know. He goes by the name Danny Dangerous. He's in a really killer band. He used to be in the ZEROS, but now he's in, of course, the Cold Blue Rebels, and he's on the phone right now. Danny Dangerous, are you there?
Hello, Reverend Eric and Sister Tracy. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for the blessing of letting me be on your show.
Woo! Thanks for being here. It's our honor.
Yeah, dude. Are you in Los Angeles?
Yeah. I'm from Southern California, and so this is where I live.
Are you guys under lockdown, or how free is it down there with the situation down there? It's all different everywhere.
It's really kind of, it's hard to see your city in such a position where, like, every single overpass, like, freeway overpass has tents in under it, and the homeless situation has gotten to the point where you just see, it kind of breaks your heart, you know what I mean? When you just see it, you just hope that this thing, you know, has a happy ending. Does that make sense? I don't know.
Yeah.
It's just a hard time.
I know what you're saying.
I watched, like, when I see what happens in Oregon or Seattle earlier, well, you know, I say earlier, but later last year, that was kind of mind-blowing to me. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Was that happening where you live in Southern Oregon?
No, not so much. Mostly up towards Portland, but we also have a homeless issue here, and I think that's something that greater America is experiencing. You know, we're seeing a lot of working class folks losing their homes and things like that too, but let's move on to what you're doing, what you've got going on. I hate to be so cut off about it, but I only have so much time to talk to you.
The sun is out and there are palm trees here, so the house is down the street.
There was no way to make that transition, like, you know, nicely, so I just...
No, that's okay. Oh, yeah, Church of Rock and Roll, that's why I'm here.
Hey, man, it's all groovy, Greg. Groovy, Greg. So anyway, Danny, how long has the Cold Blue Rebels been around?
We started in 2009. There's a lot of history before that, but I was in a band called the ZEROS, which is a... and so was the guitar player, Joe, and we had purple hair. There's actually like 3 ZEROS, but it was kind of before the internet, and the band was called the 00 ZEROS, and then they came from New Jersey to Hollywood here, where they shortened their name, and then I joined them, and then we just worked our butts off, and we all had purple hair, and it was kind of in the Guns N' Roses time, and we were in that scene, but because we were a little different, we just fit in with those bands, because they always had us open for them, and my first show with them was opening for Guns N' Roses at a club called the Coconut Teaser in a strip, and LA Guns and Jet Boy was a band that our singer was from, Mickey.
Oh, okay.
The Rebel.
Yeah.
And they were like Guns N' Roses style buddies, you know what I mean? And they were from San Francisco, and we opened for them when they got their record deal. It took us a long time to get a record deal, and then in the end, we ended up just signing to a larger independent called Enigma, which was, it was basically, and they split off to Restless, which it was just like everybody stayed at Enigma to Capitol, and like us and the Cramps were like Ruthless, Restless, you know what I mean?
Hey, Danny, how would you describe your genre of music again? What are you guys called?
Well, that band, we were into, like, 70s glam, like your former guest suite, you know, we were really into Bowie, and we were really into the Ramones, and, like, Cheap Trick, and the Beatles, and stuff. It was kind of like the Ramones met with the Beatles, so we did a lot of different stuff.
I was referring to the Cold Blue Rebels, though.
Oh, okay. Well, we stopped doing that, but then, I was just working my job, and then somehow I ran into Mickey, and I had been hanging kind of in the rockabilly scene forever after that. My girlfriend was a rockabilly girl. I just like that music. I like that scene. And then when I met Mickey, he was into psychobilly, which is kind of like a punk out version of rockabilly.
There you go, psychobilly.
And he was really into that. And I liked a lot of the earlier psychobilly bands, so I was like, he goes, hey, if you buy a stand-up bass, I want to do this. I said, you know, hey, if you want to ever do a side band, you know, I want to be your bass player. Amazon. If you buy a stand up bass and learn how to do it, you know, I'll start a band with you. We'll do a psychobilly band. And so I did.
That's how
I
started.
I think I'd do it. But it was like, yeah, I just sold some gear, bought that. It was hard though. Like, I mean, I love the Straight Cats. You should go see them. And I have to kind of honestly give it up for Hockey Crocker, because if you're a young man trying to, or a woman trying to learn how to slap, you know, when you just tap in, I just, there wasn't really a lot of reference, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
He had like a tape. And anyway, so I learned that. And then as there was a psychobilly band out here called Los Capuentos, and their bass player, Benny, kind of helped me out, gave me some lessons. And then we started playing shows. When we started playing shows, we rose up through that scene pretty quickly. And there was a band called The Rockets who we played with a lot and we were friends with. And that leader of that band plays slap, and he really, since Tony, taught me a lot, so.
Yeah, you're rocking on stage, man. I tell you, when I got to see you guys, you came rolling through Medford, Oregon. I don't know what year that was, maybe 2011 or 12 or 13, but you came rolling through here, and you guys blew me away with your stage show. It was amazing. I remember grabbing the CD at the show, and it was just so killer. So, yeah, ever since then, I've always just loved the Cold Blue Rebels. You know, your stage show was amazing.
You know what's crazy? The psychobilly was kind of a smaller genre. We weren't into, you know, we had all been... We entered that scene not saying like, hey, we've been in bands with refugees. We didn't say anyway. We just shut up and played, you know. And but nobody really entered. We didn't feel that we entered that scene to like capitalize on it or anything. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, I remember I really didn't know who you were, but I'd heard the name, and I remember I liked you guys so much. I helped you carry your gear. I was like, I want to be your roadie.
I remember when you came up and talked to me, and I remember you being, you know, being really nice. But everybody up there was pretty nice, you know.
Yeah, Oregon.
In fact, it was I don't know, like it seemed like a lot of people were into weed up there. I don't know, is that wrong to say? Can I say that?
No, it's always been very progressive when it comes to cannabis.
All through Oregon, people would want to, they'd be like, "Your parents, wow, it's here, have some weed." They want to give you weed. I'd be like, I'll just never forget. Like, I'd never been through that before. You know?
Yeah, if you can get it free around here a lot, you know, if you really need it.
Yeah, I was okay, but I just meant that, you know, I thought it's any token of appreciation. I was like, hey, just say thank you, school. But I don't know. I remember, we played that place. We went up there. I remember it was just a long trip. It was our first time there. We made that trip many times after that. But I remember we played, when I played that club, I couldn't believe just when getting there, like, you know, we played Berkeley and we just make our way up there and you're not thinking anything. And then when you get to that small town, you go into that club, that guy really put some love into that club.
Yeah, he's talking about going. He's talking about Johnny B's in Medford, Oregon.
Yeah. Johnny B's with like glitter bar stools, like he just had it going on. I go, this is a, you know, hot rod Billy Club right here, you know what I mean?
And, yeah, Johnny's been in the valley for years and years, way before I came here, that's for sure.
But it was cool, and he was really a nice guy, and everybody there was, I remember we rocked it. Every show like that, I just felt, it sounds kind of weird, but when you're playing with your buddies, especially, I don't know, for me when I was getting older, I just felt like that was almost a second chance to just really rock, and I figured, all right, you know, you never know how long a band's going to last, so I was like, I'm going to rock it as hard as I can. I don't care if just the bartender, I'm going to do it.
Well, no, you made an impression on me, bro, that's for sure, because, you know, it's just a small area, but you guys came in and killed it, man, and it wasn't a bad show, but it wasn't packed either, but you made it, it didn't matter. It could have been 1,000 people because you guys played like there was. That was awesome.
It was cool. We ended up getting, the Cobra Rebels ended up getting a little record deal through our buddy, which his name's Wednesday 13, and he's actually, I don't know, I guess you could say metal, but like goth metal, or I don't know, they just, all I know is there's a whole scene across the country of, I don't know what you'd call it, but it's like, make a B.
I used to know Wednesday 13 a long time ago.
Yeah, he's really, he liked us from our other bands back in the day, and he somehow just said, hey, I'm going to help you out, and he did, and he hooked us up with trying to put a record out, and it was so quick. It was like literally within, it was just within a few months, like we had a record out, and John Justin, the guy that was his manager at the time, head of the record company, kind of hooked us up with this. He just got us rolling. And then once we had played around a lot, Wednesday said, oh, I'm going to take you on tour with me. And we had toured the country once with the Rockets already. And then we got on another, like, he would have a package thing called, like, the Summer Slaughter Tour or something like that, and we'd be on it. And we did that with him, like a few times.
Sweet, brother. We're going to end up playing some of your tunes here momentarily. I wanted to ask, I know it's in this age of pandemic, and it's really strange for all of us musicians, so it's kind of hard to say, but what does the future hold for Code Blue Rebels, or what do you hope it holds?
Well, I think almost any band at this point, like, if you're really just look at why you started, you know, like, I don't know, but, like, I spent my life going to shows, like, I wasn't into football or like, basketball, you know, I was into,
amen,
at the back of record covers going, like, who produced this, who did the record cover,
amen,
you know, like, oh my God, they just lost the bass player, but he wrote a lot of the good songs, what happened, you know, like, that was my life,
that's great,
and I looked at that, and, yeah, I'm in a band, you've been in bands, but it, to me, it's the whole package. So the fact that I'm still playing with buddies that I've known forever, you know, I don't care what, like, our future, you know, if I play a show, you know, if I play a bunch of shows, but I know that we're going to write some tunes and so on. We put an EP out right before that was, like, the end of 2019, because we still get a lot of hits on our, like, streaming stuff.
Yeah.
So we just took whatever money was in our little bank account. We went in and wrote three songs and put it out.
Well, you know,
put it back in.
I'm always interested in your stuff, and anyone that's interested, of course, YouTube contains so many great videos and songs by Code Blue Rebels. We picked a song tonight to do called Cold, Blue, and Beautiful, which is absolutely a rocker. And I want to say thanks a million to Danny Dangerous for taking some time out of his schedule in Los Angeles to grace the airwaves of the Church of Rock. And I really appreciate it, brother, you know. It's always good talking to you.
Thank you, bro. Anytime, man. I loved it. So, yeah, I'll talk to you soon. And you can hit us up on the Facebook, or I think we just started our Instagram. You can call us there. But basically, just listen to Church of Rock, right?
Yeah, Sister Tracy wants to say bye.
Yes, thank you so much, Hunter, for being with us, and we look forward to round two. We'd love to have you back.
Oh, thanks. Well, thank you for the blessing, Sister Tracy.
Of course.
And,
well, we are very proud to play your music, brother. And everyone out there, if you're listening, please turn it up just a little bit louder, because it's going to get dangerous in here.
Yeah. Thank you.
Take care, my brother. It's Cold Blue Rebels, Cold Blue and Beautiful at KSKQ and the Almighty Church of Rock, where Sister Tracy's going to hit a little button. We're going to kick some butt here. See you, Danny. Thank you, bro.